So I think you will hear a lot about Pavia because the next forum actually will be held in Pavia. So let's hope that all of you will be there also, and that you, I'm sure you enjoyed this forum. So now we'll just take only 5 minutes of your attention, and thanks Angel to give me this opportunity. So I know that yesterday in the manifesto, you talked a lot also about sustainability, how to make the university campus more greener. So the university, the student of the University of Pavia realized a very quick survey that I think Angel has already sent to you. Isn't it? You receive it in some group? I think in the Facebook group, in the, sorry, WhatsApp group. Did you receive the link? Angel, che lo inviaste? Ah, Telegram, okay. But so it is a very short form that I invite you to fill in now, if you can. So, I mean, I can work hopefully next week to analyze the result. And the focus, the aim of this very short questionnaire is because from 20 to 28th of November, it's the European Week for Waste Reduction. So we want, and this week is the biggest campaign to raise awareness about waste prevention in Europe. So since AC2U, it's about the life of, I mean, we talk a lot how to improve the life in campus university. We want to hear your voice in order to make the life in the campus more sustainable. So to see which sustainability policy has been adopted in your university, and then we will start from the analysis of this data to sharing best practice, to make a big discussion, hopefully, in the Forum of Pavia. So thank you so much to fill in this questionnaire, if you can now, or let's say during this day. So we are sure that you will not forget it. And if you can disseminate also the link through your friends, your colleagues, we will really appreciate it. So thanks a lot, and I hope that the thematic, it's... I mean, you are interested about the thematic, and we can further discuss in other occasion. So thank you, Angel. I thank you, all of you, to fill in the form.
Well, dear Julia, thank you very much for being so active in different aspects. So, yeah, we are arriving to a point where the main issue and the main concern, and somehow it has been even the concern of the last 2 days, not only or is the concern of the whole ECTU alliance, how to train the student of the 21st century. Today we are going to talk about this academic session, debate about the future of higher education. What do students need? Well, as you know, the whole activities, plans, study plans, research groups are somehow focused in order to train the next or the future education generation. And now, but sometimes we do not consider, or we forget, it's better said, that those who are the objective of these initiatives are not always asked what they need, what should be done, and how they see this reality from a student perspective. And this is a golden occasion to debate about it. This is why we do have also a nice group of ECTU student network that is still here, and I'm sure that there are ideas, there are suggestions, there are also concerns, because we are not just building on the short-term project. We are focusing on the long-term project that is starting from now and will start in a practical way in 2027-2030. This is why it's crucial to know what your ideas are, what your wishes would be in order to improve the higher education system. Because it's you must and you are part of this process where you will prepare the terrain, the field for the next European generation. This is why it is absolutely needed to know how do you see it, how do you feel it, and what you mean that could be done in order to improve what we are focusing on. Because professors, of course, we have never forgotten that we have been students, but we are talking in past tense, and you are the present, and we are focusing on the future. So it's always good to have your vision upon what could be done, what aspects should be added to what we have proposed, because I'm honest to you, what we are doing is precisely for you. Why is for you? Because our aim is to train you as better as we are able to. But it's also good to hear how you see it, how you would like to focus the whole process in order to see what is needed. Because we work the study plans, we work a whole project, the system. We propose a system where even the European Commission takes it seriously. But sometimes we commit also the inconvenience to see and to understand and to also to launch and to propose initiatives that are really only one-sided and not both-sided. Why I'm telling this? When we started with the Bologna process, probably most of the students were not born, probably. And when we put in application the system, we saw and we realized that there were many aspects that were not considered. Because, let's say, the politics haven't done what they are doing now. Asking the staff, the teaching staff, asking the students what really is needed in order to improve and to have a better, a much more complete European higher education system. And we are on time. This is why EC2U project or alliance is focusing on, let's say, on these three main pillars: innovation, research, and education. We haven't done it just because we were inspired as researchers, as specialists in different fields. No. We made a question. What is needed for this generation? What can we do in order to contribute to your future system? Because you will be then the followers or the following generation that will train the incoming European student generation. This is why we consider that it's important to listen to you, to take note of what you see and what you suggest in order to complete what we are really now developing as a project. It's a pilot project. And you are a full part of the project. You are not just I don't know how somebody could imagine that, yeah, well, students have never been asked, students have never been considered, students have been not that and that. But I think now it's time that also we learn to hear, because as this morning we have been suggesting many ideas, many proposals, many dreams, and so on, we could also have some specific ideas of what the students and how the students feel let's say, what is needed? Because this is the main reason why we are here. And after saying these short words, I will give the floor to our student representative, that he is not only part of the ECTU alliance, but he is also deeply engaged in the development of student network at the University of Salamanca with his group, which is contributing also daily to the improvement of the proposals we do inside the university. So they participate in even decision making periods. So they are also somehow policy makers in many senses. And this is why it's good to have and the occasion to listen to you, to see what you suggest, to see what you feel that is needed in order to improve the, let's say, our main purpose, a better, solid European higher education for the next 10 years. We have been talking about 2030. 2030 is there. And if we don't push forward, I think we would lose a huge occasion to prepare the ground for the next generation. You are the present, but we have to focus on the future. And it's good to see how you see it, how you feel it, and to transmit us what is needed in order to accomplish with our vocation and obligation, helping to go forward for a better higher education. Angel, I'm going to give the floor to you. I'm very sorry I'm not going to be able to be with you because we have also other commitments, because many changes take place without having been foreseen before. But I'm sure that some conclusions will come out, suggestions for sure will be given, and you can be sure also that we will take them seriously into account in order to improve the proposal we are working on. So it's not just a question of simple impression that students are considered. No, no, you are part of it. You have also to contribute to it, and I'm sure that you will give us many, many interesting and useful ideas and visions in order to enlarge this big ECTU community. Thank you.
Thank you, Ephraim. And now I would like to welcome the buddies from ESM Pavia, because they asked for a sort of slot of time for a presentation for them. So the floor is completely yours. If I can have the presentation, chick, me pueden poner la presentación en están ahí. Okay, they are on it. Yours.
All yours, Mateo.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Okay. First of all, I want to call Yolanda if she's here, my friend of Yes and Yash. She's here? No, probably she's late. Okay, so I'll do it by my own. First of all, I want to make this presentation because last September, 2 months ago, we made the first post-pandemic mobility between ESN Pavia and ESN Yash, that are two associated partners. These two associate partners meet each other almost 1 year before. And it all happened in November 2020. In November 2020, we were actually in pandemic in Italy. Everything was closed and we just had Zoom calls. After this Zoom conference, I met all the other ESN section. I saw some presentation from the prorectors, from the municipalities, and also from the ESN. So I discovered that there were other sections, part of this project, part of this alliance, that feel probably the same as me. So they feel like that they are important because they represent a part of students, but they don't do anything for that. So I find all the email, all the other participants, and I send them an email to them. But for sure, each of us has some problem and has some something to do that is maybe more important or is work, you know. So we need 2 months to meet each other, that are an online meeting for sure. But with that first section of ESN, four different group of people joined this event, and it was Yashi, Jena, Salamanca, and Pavia. And we make a project. We try to make a podcast together. Because during pandemic, we start a project called Step on Air. That is a podcast in which students can make his voice to be heard. So they can like express themselves. We make like an episode about the pandemic fatigue. We make an episode about the LGBTQ question. So we try to free, you know, students. So we thought, why we cannot make an episode of our podcast with ESN Yash? Since that we are far, that's the only thing we can do. But after that, we start this kind of friendship, because we start talking to each other, we start to know each other, especially Roxana, that is the previous president of ESN Yash. And after this friendship, we joined their events, like a week dedicated to communication. And after that, there was another unofficial meeting of the C2U Alliance, in which each section of ESN joined and expressed themselves. And I discovered that each section and each ESN organization, as a student and a partner associated, work in a different way. There are some sections that make the welcoming of students like doing some events, some like fun events. There are some other sections that organize, for example, grants for making events for the environment and other things like that. So we decided to hurry up in our project and we discover and we record this episode. I've got a little picture of this between Joanna, that was our communication manager, that she is from Yash, that is the city which was friendship, and Raresh, a guy from Yash. But unfortunately, our podcast was based on the pandemic, and when we recorded this podcast, everything was open again in Italy. So it was useless. It was good material, but maybe for a year that is already gone. So we decided to start something different. We say, since everything is open, why shouldn't we meet? So during the summer, we set everything by our own, I can say. But for sure, Julia helped me a lot, because Julia is our local coordinator. And we found for them the plane, we found for them the accommodation, and we try to help as much as we can. Then for sure our job could be kind of say done, because the local coordinator could talk to each other and find a way to make this dream reality. But at the end, in September, we finally meet, and I can say it was like a dream that come true. After 2 years of pandemic, after 2 years of people that can only be seen in a screen like this, in a camera, maybe now we all are all together and it seems something normal. But after that 2 years, this September was really special. And it was a photo of when we met for the first time. We came to the airport to took them, and it was Raluca on the left, then Rosa, Gianluca, me, Roxana, Christy, Yolanda, and Aaron. And it was a special moment because we are kind of a stranger, because we never met in person. We just speak like Zoom call, like WhatsApp. It's just like you have a good friend, but you never meet him, like a far friend. But doesn't mean that he's less than what he is real. And then this is a photo of all the institution of our relief. Some people that are here are also in this photo. And we make like a big event during our welcome week, because this was the week in which we welcome the international student, for example, the Erasmus. After that, we make a presentation, but unfortunately, I don't have a photo of that, in which we present our association. A national member of our network came, that is Alessio Burlon, and also Yolanda and Roxana present our association in the university presentation show. So it was really a special moment, but unfortunately I cannot have a photo here. After that, they came for a reason, for sharing best practice. We found this kind of funny and typical way to discover what is Romanian culture. So they said that we have a Romanian dance. And it was a really special moment in which they dress up as this typical dance, and they show us how to do that and how and why there are some deep roots. And then in these days we spoke a lot, and there are no photos for showing you and explaining to you what does it mean for us to share our experience, to speak to each other, to discover that this alliance is not just a word, but it's possible and it's real. When two when two different representative of city meet each other, means that is a start, and there's the first step of a long friendship. And this is a photo, for example, in which we are showing them the beauty of Pavia. And finally, we record this podcast. It's not even online, but soon it will be, in which we speak about the EC2U Alliance. We speak about themselves, and it's for sure longer than this little and small presentation. And I hope that when it's going to be online, even everybody could see it and could hear it, because it's really important. Well, that's everything. I also put Yolanda here. And now I have a small video to show you something better than my words. Thank you.
I'm Yolanda, and I'm the president of YesN Iași.
Okay, so thanks, Matteo. Julia has explained us what is being done, and Matteo has explained us what was done until now. So now it's time to speak about what should be done from now on. So I will kindly ask another student from Pavia, for example, and at least two other students from the other universities to join us in a stage. I think we have at least chairs for two from each of the universities, so please feel free. There is also mics for the public, so don't worry if you don't need to be on the stage to participate, but please don't leave us alone here. So feel free to come up here. Not everyone at the same time, please. Yeah, of course. We still have room for more people. Okay. So, is anyone else joining, or should we start? Yeah, that's the spirit. Going one way and then the other way.
Yeah, you're correct.
Just keep the mic there. Great. Okay, so welcome everyone to this debate or roundtable or however you want to call this. Yesterday afternoon we have some time to talk with each other about different topics, about the main four topics that we are going to speak about today. And this is the objective of this roundtable, is to draw the conclusions and the task list to have in the manifesto that we as easy-to-use students should prepare and launch for the Alliance to keep in mind. So this is going to work this way. I'm going to throw you some questions, and we have one mic that will be running from one side to another. So I want you to answer them freely and then pass the mic one by one. We are going to use only that mic, not those, because it's difficult to move them. So using that mic, and that's the idea. Any questions so far? Okay, great. So the first topic we talked about yesterday was sustainability. We talked a little about the green gadgets, and we speak also a bit about how to tackle these things as students. So the first question I want to launch to you is, can we as students make any change in the universities and have any impact in the sustainability of our universities? So let's start from that side, and then we pass the mic. Sorry, you're the first.
Yes, we've talked about, like, as you said, the sustainability goals, and that it would be not just ecological sustainability, but as well social and a long-lasting sustainability. So our first thoughts were, how can we achieve that, and what would be, like, the idea to get the people and the students involved? So how to make it attractive to take part in it? Yeah, so that was like the starting point of everything.
What we are talking about yesterday.
Okay, as well about, we discussed the main educational problems, so
Sustainability.
Well, and we discussed the ways how we can engage students in each university with gamification, rewards, etc., into more ecological and sustainable lifestyle.
And we split into three questions that were about the barriers that we face. We collected the strength in our own universities about the sustainability. And after that, we collected some ideas how to make our own campus and the European campus more sustainable.
Okay, I think that discussion of yesterday was so important because we discovered that maybe it's not about changing thing, it's just about changing thing about us. Important thing is to change our mindset about the future and about what is going to be this campus for the student. So it's important that it's going to be made by the students. Thank you.
And we also said that it was something that had to be done step by step, starting little and then little by little getting bigger and having big actions at the end that could really change our university for a more sustainability way of living and studying.
So I believe that before we try to make a change, we have to be represented in the student, in the university bodies and where decisions are made. So student representation is the main topic of change. When you talk about sustainability and sustainability measures, that can be empty if we are not represented where the students can make a voice and can make the change. So first, we have to strengthen relations with the universities and be represented in student councils and the general council. That's where change is made. And present proposals that make sense and go step by step with little changes. Not try to make a big change at once, but have a strategic plan for maybe say 3 years, where we, in those 3 years, improve our campus in the sustainability matters. Thank you.
Well, I think that nothing in life will come overnight. So with little steps, first improving our actions and our way of living, and afterwards becoming models for the ones around us, would help our university community to grow. So I believe that engaging in students' association could help us have our voices heard. So we should just take it slow, and we'll get to the final victory.
And also considering the fact that, as we know, one of the priorities of EC2U for 2023 and 2030 is universities which are more student-centered, where the bodies of students have more autonomy and can decide for more topics around the student's life. Considering this, what we talked yesterday was also the fact that students have to be aware of how important sustainability and keeping costs at the same time is essential to improve the quality of both academic but also social life around the university.
Okay, so as we said yesterday, our universities, most of them face also infrastructural barriers, as most of them are like historical buildings. So as we said, we didn't think about big changes, but more of a think of our behaviors. That is something more doable also in the short term. And another thing that we discuss is that sustainability is such a wide concept, so it requires the collaboration of different characters of the university. So, as we said, representation among different departments and bringing together the different point of view could actually lead to, let's say, remarkable activities that can involve all the students.
As we said yesterday, sustainability is really a more and more important concept in our life. And so as the campus and the university is kind of for us students, it's really important that the change come from us and that we go like really step by step, because big changes are not easy for students, but step by step we can like introduce really the sustainability in our campus.
So you said that we need representation, and also one of the ideas that has been wandering around in almost all the interventions is that we need little steps. So with that representation, and having in mind that what we have to do is take little steps instead of a great leap forward, what are the things or the ideas that you think should be implemented from our side? Those little steps, throw some ideas, like one idea or two ideas, don't need to elaborate them a lot.
So we talked about like the little step that we can implement in our university. For example, environmental changing, but with through games or things like that. For example, we talked about throwing rubbish with a basketball game, and so you're not like aware that you're doing a good thing, but you're doing it because it's like kind of funny. So you make the change without really thinking about it.
Yeah, and another idea that we came up yesterday was, for example, about transportation. And we discussed about, for example, about improving bike sharing or other sustainable, more sustainable ways to ease the transportation for students among all the different departments in the city campus.
And also considering that students are still in the trend of being conscious of how important being sustainable is, we discussed about how good, let's say, would measures like furthering the process of doing everything digitalized, not using notebooks or paper anymore. And also trying to consider making the meals more plant-based rather than meat, considering that as a plant-based, as a sustainable way. And also another idea would be that of having more advantages and benefits towards using less transport and, yes, bikes, as was mentioned before.
I think it's crucial to understand that each student is different from each other and all of us have different needs. And I think one first step would be making the administration of the universities aware that these differences exist and that we're not all the same.
In Coimbra, I think the university is doing a really good job in this matter by using, for example, solar panels for energy, also making students aware of the SDGs. That's a positive point. Also, we can improve that. We can have, for example, more recycling bins, for example, creating a community garden for students to grow their crops. And yeah, thank you.
Also, we talked about the fact that if you want to make it a habit for the students, institutions have to also do an effort. And we talked about waste, food waste. And we had the idea of using all the vegetables and the fruits that wasn't being sold in day one to make, like, for example, a discount or give them for free the day after to the students that want some. And we talk with our Portuguese homologues about, for example, the planning of what you want to eat and the reservation of the meals that could reduce the waste of food.
And also, as I said before, the change of mindset could need probably even for students to be encouraged to do some change. Some change could be led, for example, from some reward that every student need, for example, because we spoke about the using some trash, some trash bin in some campus, and for if you recycle, for example, an amount, a certain amount of bottle, you receive something like a voucher that you can use, for example, for buying some book or for using for some university university thing. So it could let for your university to encourage the student and for student to save some something for them and be encouraged. So I think it one of these ideas that showed up yesterday and it could be used maybe. Thanks.
We also spoke about a thing that's existing in Coimbra in the cafeteria that you can, before the meal is prepared, order it online, or you can just vote. So the food waste is not that big when people come in and make spontaneous decisions. And also I wanted to mention that since it is lasting long to make small steps, it should be a broad term, like we need to see it in a broad term, to so besides the economic and ecologic aspects, there are also the social aspects of sustainability, because a university is run by people that need to work and that need to be healthy, especially physical, no, psychological healthy, physical as well. So that's also, we also need to mention that.
I just wanted to add something what you've said about public transport and like buses or using the bike. So that maybe could be a good aspect where the university, we as ESN, and the cities or municipalities of all the universities could work together, because with your student's ID card, maybe you can use the public transport as well, or you can rent a bike for half an hour, what's already possible in some cities. So yeah, maybe that's a good connection point.
I wanted to summarize and add something what was told about being represented in general and about being well-informed or not. So implementing any idea, including that, it is crucial, informatization and, like, let's say, campaign. So have a person who will represent and promote the idea is important, and a lack of communication or existence of communication between those who already inside of university have social media like platforms to promote something, and communication between them is important, as for example usage of applications if the university already have one to catch attention of students and promote it digitally. And yeah, as Ines already told, it's generally digitalization can be a part of sustainability and eco campaign as well. So improving communication and using all associations, right, and organizations that we already have, but with active promotion of that idea can help in modern world, especially if we still have half online, yes, and half not online studies. Thank you.
Any more thoughts about this? Yeah, add it.
So I forgot to say it before, but the new Erasmus Plus program 2021-27 has a topic that's about Erasmus without papers. So we are being incited by the European Commission to transform our universities and how mobilities work to digitalize. And I believe that that should be a priority for the next years for every university, depending on if it's an alliance university, but promote that digitalization within the universities. Thank you.
Okay, so with this we finish the sustainability part of this. So let's move to the next topic. Yesterday, one of the things we talked about is SDG4, the quality of education, and a lot of concerns were raised about problems inside the teaching with the professors. And now the question is not what are those problems or how to solve those problems, but if we have tools to solve that problems right now, and if we don't, if you can come up with any tools about that. So we start from that side.
So as you said before, maybe the first step would be that the students have a speech or have a voice in decision-making processes. So like that there will be a students council, or there is already that students, for example, have a say in which professor would be the next one to come to university, so that they could have a say in their own quality of education.
So yeah, I think communication is the key, as we said it before, but I think it's one of the most important things to start changing, as you said. And I think representation of students is also important. What could be done to improve the level of education, the quality of the education, will be, for example, to modernize the facilities at a little level. Doesn't have to be like big changes, but for example, just having some access to a good quality internet, Wi-Fi, some things like that that we need in our everyday life as students, because everything is getting to be working with technology and on the internet. And so I think it's one of the things that could, that can be done really quickly, and that can be really efficient to level up the quality of education.
I think an important point to be made here is also is again student representation, but good student representation. Our representatives should be aware of these problems and should be able to have a straight line communication to the rest of the students, so they are aware. Also, in terms of pedagogical skills, I think teachers should be empowered with communication tools and communication skills, so they can pass the information better to students. That's sometimes we have researchers that are really good at their field, but they cannot pass that information because of the communication. And if the communication fails, the teaching will fail, and students will not have good learning. So those are two important points to keep in mind: communication and representation. Thank you.
I think when it comes to a good education, you need like three parts. One is the student, one is the teacher, and one is the educational system in the country. So if one of those fails, everything is going to fail. So for the teachers, they need to understand their students, and this goes vice versa. The students also need to understand the teachers. And for this to happen, as my colleagues already said, there needs to be a very good communication and also straightforward, no hiding, no fear, just say what the problem is, because everybody needs to be aware of the problem. If that is not going to happen, everybody is going to think that everything is fine, which is not.
Globalization has had a very drastic effect on education as well as in every field of life, making education way more different than what it was like 10 years or even 20 years ago, making it very accessible, meaning that we have universities today which are very international, and the internationalization of these universities, we consider that should be like advanced even more, because an international community inside universities will help all the community of local like city, but even country, both social and economical development. But we also consider the fact that education still has and faces a lot of issues. Issues that sometimes are not addressed because sometimes are not accepted. Issues like the fact that students need to advance, like I said. We cannot go, let's say, with methods of 10 years or 20 years ago in the teaching today, because it is more modern, like everything has changed. So being up to date with the methodology of teaching and also the awareness of the students being a part, very active part of the whole university administration and decision making is very important.
And yeah, another point that we raised in our debate was about motivation, and another problem that public universities are facing is that maybe a lot of students after the first year, maybe they or change courses or they just quit, and I think that one of the reasons could be the loss of motivation, maybe because there could be a lack of information about the whole academic career that they can have, and many details about the study plans that are missing maybe at the beginning, and also when you're at the end of the academic career, it is important to find a way to relate what you're studying with the society and the contribution you can give to the society, or your own inspiration that you want to achieve. So I think that some tools, as we mentioned also the importance of finding some tools, could be mentorship that maybe is missing in universities, and I think it's a point that can be improved, as universities should be the place where you can find inspiration and sort of direction, and then you should not be forced to go outside to find this kind of inspiration and motivation. So I think that that could be a point that can be improved.
And we also raised another point still on communication, which is the fact that many facilities or even the welcoming isn't always translated, like it's mostly in the European community, in the language of the university, which is kind of normal. But I'm thinking about the Erasmus students, who are not always speaking the language of the country, and even if this is multiple translations, because English is not always the solution, it can maybe help the communication between the Erasmus students and the students of the university, and help them to integrate themselves and etc.
Okay, thanks. So the title of this session is about the future of the European higher education area and the future of universities seen by the students. So now is the time to for me to ask you about the future of university. I want you to think about what would be for you the perfect future university. Let's start with the infrastructure part. What should a university have, and what must a university have for it to be the university of the future, as in the building and services matter? Just start there.
So I think that, of course, the university can have a big future, and it can pass through multiple concepts like international or the sustainability and every point we discussed, actually, because they are really like preparing the future, and as they are integrated into the different campuses and etc., they can really build a new university to make it like the perfect university like we all want, a university where there is equality, where the sustainability is like everywhere, we do not waste anything, etc.
A perfect university environment would be the one of a multi-dimensional space where students don't feel obliged to go because they have, and it's obligatory for them to go because they have to sign something. It should be a place where students are eager to go because they want to interact with each other and they feel important. Also, other than, as we talked before about international students, something that has worked in the past and maybe like even advanced more in the future is international staff, which is very important as well. Another step could be more funds allocated for research, making different universities, let's say our 7 universities in this part of this forum, be research leaders in different fields, both sociological or scientific. Yes.
When it comes to infrastructure, I think an university's main role should be education. So students should have access to information, both on news and also on, I don't know, whatever they are studying. So they need books. The books should also be printed, but also on the online space, like an online library or something. More like a free library. So, yeah. Also, students should have a place to stay, and the university should look into that, and also have a decent price, or also maybe free, depends on the possibilities. Transport from the place that they're staying to the university should be also accounted for. And of course, there should be taken into account everything that all the students need, not only those that come from outside the city, but also those that live inside the city and don't have some possibilities. I think a perfect university would take into account everything that all of its students need.
As the two colleagues before said, I believe that innovation should be a key point. And universities should have research and development units and therefore project management units, so that information is constantly updated, and that information should be passed to students and make students involved in the research itself. I believe that a good campus should make available for students canteens at reasonable prices, dorm rooms for most of the students. Also, grants for students in poorer conditions, transportation, as my colleague said before. So basically, be aware of the students' needs and establish a close relationship to the students. Universities should be close to students, not far from them. They should, the policies they implement, they are for the students, but if they are not, if they are far from them, just people sitting in a room deciding what's best without including students, that should not be the point. Because students are what we are here for, you know? We are discussing the future of higher education in Europe. So these are key points. Thank you.
I would just add an access, a free access and a complete access to technology, to materials needed, books, everything a student can need. And also us, we are here at ECTU, and access to international resources such as conferences, such as articles translated in different languages, because it has to be accessible for everyone, even if you don't have a perfect English.
And we are speaking about the future, and I think that after university there is the world of the work. So I think that it's also important to, after the first 2 years, to create a connection between the people that found a job, for example, for a specific course. So maybe in the future it's going to be easier for the people to get a graduation or get a specific course to take the right path. So this thing, I think, could be a good idea for the future. And thank you.
I'm joining my colleagues to the points that were said, and I wanted to emphasize that sustainability as a goal, or many different goals to the own different things that were said, are not just a goal that you achieve once and then it's there. It's like a status that needs to stay on that point, like a level that needs to be kept. So it's important to reflect and permanently watch what is happening, because it could get like worse, or it's not something that you reach and then it's there. It needs to be watched, or that's very important, and I think people should be responsible for, like, all of the people should be responsible for watching what's happening. And yeah.
Okay. Actually, in different countries, you can find research results made on what students think about the university, their critique, their dissatisfiedment or satisfiedment with something. And actually, accessibility to digital and non-digital resources will be in top. Those other things, surprisingly, everything been still monolingual, as you mentioned, despite the fact that a huge number of international students studies every year in all European, a lot of European universities, let's say. But it's still, it is a process that at some campuses, universities even didn't start it. So it's monolingual, and it's surprising for global world, right? And talking about students, most of them now, majority of students, they are very professionally oriented. So a lot of their critique will be connected with, it is already connected with, not modern knowledge, right? Using old methods, and it's really hard to keep up with that speed changes, the speed of changes in our world in general, and academically, it's also hard to keep up, but I guess it will be actually in top of complaints. So it's like theoretical, not empirical knowledge that we cannot probably use or we don't really understand how to use in our career, in our professional life after. So involvement probably of professionals who currently worked in your future sphere would help, because actually departments do that, but not on regular basis, or really rarely, or don't do that at all, right? International environment itself, it's a great advantage that can be used if everybody could be heard. So communication, one more time, and representation. So yeah, without any power, we can't affect decision making. So literally such forums, but locally, inside of your university, probably would make a great change. Grazie, I wanted to say thank you.
And for sure, as Francisco said before, it's important to create a space for students in which they can talk and they can speak and they can find a better place and a better world, because the future is not just about decided today, because every year could be a new idea and a new changement. And so that's why we need to discuss, and we need space and time to discuss all together. So this thing could continue and could go on even in the next forum, for example. So.
Okay, so now I'm going to ask you to imagine that you are in charge of your university and in charge of this alliance. In front of us, there are a lot of students, but also in front of us, there are managers and there are teachers. So I want you to think about two tasks, two things that you will ask them to do. One for the managers. What could you ask the managers to do for the future of this alliance and for the future of your university? And what could you ask your fellow students to do for the future of EC2U and for the future of your university? So let's start from that side.
I'm sorry, could you like repeat your question? I couldn't hear it really good.
Yeah, so in front of us there are a lot of students, but also a lot of professors and teachers and managers. So I want you to imagine that you are in charge of this alliance and in charge of your university, and think about two tasks, something for them to do. One for the managers, what could you ask the managers to do if you were in charge? And what could you ask your fellow students to do if you were in charge? If you have the power to tell them, do this. One for the managers and one for the students. Okay? Go on.
Maybe the first thing that would be a good communication between all the actors. So, like that the head of the university, the administration staff, but the students as well, that they at every time know what are the problems and what are the things that are really running good, so that you can think all in a whole, all together with the partners as well, so that's not just the, I don't know, the university doing their work, but together with the partners as well, so that there could be the best essence of everyone in the alliance. So yeah, maybe that would be a really strong communication. Maybe you want to add something?
Excuse me, I wanted to define one for students, right? I need to define activity or what?
Something for them to do. If you could ask them, okay, you need to become a better university or a better alliance. You have to
for improvement.
Yeah, for improvement.
Okay.
We're supposed to improve the universities.
Two is not enough, but for management, investments in grants, in research, and in something what can increase the engagement into basically, okay, our responsibilities as students are studying, right? So what can, and talking about students, we potentially, and future of education, we are talking about a future of a country, actually, because students are a resource of innovation, potential economic prosperity, and everything that we will have in the future of each country, and science, right? So, of course, that is important. And about students, probably be more socially active, because we can observe, I guess, some decrease of activity of students now. It's connected with what I told before. Now people kind of, and students, become more individualistic. So that's why they're very centered on their own career and their own fate and path, instead of being cooperative and actually socially active. Okay, those students who are here now, probably quite socially active. So that's a good representation and good examples of students. But actually overall, if we think about all our departments and groups, probably it will not be a majority, for sure it will not be. So those, thanks.
Since we're still talking about hypothetical future, a structure would be very important to divide the tasks for the certain parts of sustainability, for in case a student has a need or concern or maybe ideas, who is the person that the student is talking to? Is it a teacher or anybody else? Where is the collection of ideas? Like, where is the place to talk? A forum, maybe online, or a think tank, or I don't know, you can upload it on Google, or just to have a place to collect and to discuss.
Okay, I wrote something about this question because I think it's very important. Because everybody said that if you are in charge, what do you do? So I guess that now we have the opportunity to say that. And I think that the first thing that I think is important for this alliance is to increase the mobility, even small projects. Because if you encourage that, you make people think that it's possible and this alliance is real, it's more real than just to meet outside. And to make this process easier, I know that it's hard, but to make it as easy as possible. Because after that, people will know each other, and work with people that you know well, it's easier. So everything could lead to a better future and an easy start for the future. And the second thing, I think that is also important, is to increase communication of this alliance between students. Because lots of students could have lots of ideas that maybe nobody will listen to them because they don't know about this alliance. So I think that the communication from inside the universities could be like more powerful. And thanks to that, probably there's going to be an easier future. So those are my two ideas. Thank you.
And to complete what my colleague said, I think it's important for example, students that are here today to stay in touch with the next students that are gonna come after us to exchange on our experience. Also, I think if I had to say something about the SETU that could be improved is to let the opportunity for students, but also for teachers, to have a moment of exchange, of discussion on the way of learning, the methodology, and also on what we can create together, and that is also valuable for students. I think it could be really a good thing for students to have big time, like right now, but also, for example, a whole morning, a whole day of discussion on subjects we can exchange and then conclude on, for example, a start of a project between the seven university and the seven universities, sorry, and the different students that want to be involved.
So regarding the teachers, I believe they should promote the increase of the students that participate in the that have grants of the Alliance and participate in the events, because the student representation and student participation is really important. Also, promote more research and development, the participation of students in the Alliance's work groups, and keep them informed of what are the developments. And, for example, also guide them to the workplace in the sense that what are you getting from this experience? What is this going to change in your life and make you reach goals, personal goals, in a more efficient way? Regarding students, I think they should participate. Participate in the activities of the Alliance, not only this forum, but the other activities, such as the summer schools and the think tanks. And they make their opinions, they should make their opinions heard. Talk to the teachers, give feedback. Feedback is really important for everyone. Also, speak up, create strategic documents with your opinions and what do you think should change. That's basically what we are doing next with the manifesto. And also, in the universities, promote learning with footprint, ecological footprint that is reduced. Thank you.
I think it doesn't really make sense to ask managers, teachers, and students different things, because since we're all part of this big project, our goals should be the same. So we should talk, all of us together, about how we should achieve those goals, and that would be more efficient rather than asking the managers and then talking to the students who will talk to the teachers. So should be a big group made of students, teachers, and managers that work together, brainstorm together, and come with an idea that would benefit all of us.
One of the main reasons that European Union was founded was to provide a shared space which facilitates the movement, the freedom of people, capital, and labor. And in the same way, EC2U universities can create exclusive space between these seven universities, making it more attractive for universities in the future as well, but even the students that are part of these universities. In this exclusive space, we can have joint programs where students can receive similar quality of education, whether they are in Romania, in Italy, or in Portugal. This will be important for making these countries have a spotlight more than they have actually, and the spotlight that they deserve. And for students in this case, we would only ask and encourage them to be active and to let go of barriers or different things that may prevent them from wanting to have new experiences. We should urge them to try new things, to visit new countries, to learn new languages in order to widen their horizon, but also receive the same education probably in another country that they can enjoy a lot.
Okay, so the two tasks that I would ask to, starting from managers, are first of all, be reactive in the sense that we all need education to be in parallel, accessible, in presence and online. So I think that digital infrastructure can be always improved. So be reactive in the sense that we already have these solutions, they just have to improve it, and once that we will have our joint master program, that has to be perfect in order to not to make any students without accessibility to education from anywhere. And secondly, I would ask to be proactive in the sense that they should support and sustain professor in innovating their courses, or for example, relating their courses to current issues. And as Professor Werent asked, they didn't sign the contract to be innovative or experiment in new teaching ways. The university should support them and foster that. And for students, as for managers, I would ask the same. So be reactive and be proactive. So as communication now passes through emails, they should read that email or apply for that program, as you said also. And of course, this is not for us because we are all here. So we are all very proactive, but this is not for, for all of them. And be proactive in the sense that maybe if not something is not already prepared from the university, they can have the opportunity to raise their voice or create, organize that event or new extracurricular activities if they're not satisfied with what is already offered. So in that sense.
I always come back as communication, but for the managers, I think that my kind of advice would be to improve really that by the communication, like the communication between the staff, but also between the staff and the student, because it's really too bad or even sad to miss like important dates or interesting conferences because of a lack of communication, where it can even like change, I think, in an easy way. But yeah, communication is kind of important. And for the student, I would say that we need to like open our minds and go to every opportunity that we can reach, because student life is not just studies, and every opportunity that we can like reach, as I already said, or like hobbies or associative life, but even with like the Forum of ECTU, for example, or a mobility in Erasmus, that's an opportunity that can like change life and be like really an interesting and a new way to live.
Okay, thank you all. That's a really good quantity of ideas and really good ideas. Unfortunately, we've run out of time. So with this, we put a finish point to this student event, this networking event. I will use this last minute to remind all the students that are here that tonight at 9:30 at Fonseca, the other door, we have the students' gala dinner. You are all invited. So thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me here in the stay. And thanks a lot. Great ideas. And see you in the coffee break.
Thank you.
Well, good afternoon. Better said, good evening. It's a pleasure to have this special occasion to have our minister with us. And also, of course, because of the importance of the gathering, we have also our rector and our coordinator, and also our vice rector for teaching staff here with us. I would love just to introduce our first, speaker, who is our general coordinator of European Campus of City Universities Alliance, and who will start saying some few words. The floor is yours, Ludovic.
Thank you very much. Dear Minister, dear Rector, dear Vice Rectors, of course it's a real honor for me to be with you at this closing events of this EC2U week. This was a very memorable moment. It was actually the third week that we organized. The two previous ones were organized online, and this was, of course, interesting, but not as much as being here face to face or mask to mask. We had also other colleagues connected, so it was an hybrid meeting, but it was making a huge difference, and the week has been extremely fruitful, but we are now really looking forward this last part to hear you, Minister, on the very important topic about inclusion in particular. This is absolutely key to our alliance, and we will, I guess, exchange during the debate after that. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, dear Professor Tilly. And allow me to introduce you our main speaker of today. We have the honor to have our minister for here with us. And before giving him the floor, I would love to just highlight some few lines of his huge career, his curriculum vitae. Of course, we were obliged to just resume it. After such a hard work and for a long period, sometimes it costs to just summarize, but allow me to just highlight some important features. Our minister, José Luis Escrivá, is Minister of Inclusion, Social Security and Migration since 2020. He has been the first president of the Independent Authority for Fiscal Responsibility from March 2014 until his appointment as minister, and furthermore from November 2015 to November 2019, he was president of the Network of Independent Fiscal Institutions of the European Union. He started his, long career at the Spanish, what we call Banco de España, Spanish public bank, where he held different positions in the research service and later continued in Europe, where he actively participated in the monetary integration process since 1993 as an advisor to the European Monetary Institute. With the creation of the Monetary Union, he was appointed head of the Monetary Policy Division of the European Central Bank in Frankfurt between 2012 and 2014. He was director of the Bank for International Settlements in Basel for the American continent. Between 2004 and 2012, he worked in BBVA Group, first as chief economist and director of the research service, and as of 2010, as managing director of the public finance area. He has a degree in economics from the Complutense University of Madrid with an extraordinary degree award, and has postgraduate studies in economic analysis at the University, the mentioned university, Universidad Complutense de Madrid, and in econometrics at the Bank of Spain. Throughout his career, he has published numerous articles and research papers, mainly on financial and monetary matters. So we could continue telling what this long list of his activities as responsible for other issues, but I think we will. It's better that he tells us about what he is going to tell this evening. He will delight us with a topic which is called "What do we know about migration and what should we do about it?" Minister, yeah, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. I want to start sincerely by thanking the Universidad de Salamanca, con su rector aquí, by his kind invitation to participate in this event and the whole European campus of city universities for the event you have organized and this welcome. I have gone through your agenda, and it's indeed a very dense one, a very ambitious one. I imagine that you have your discussions and interactions during this day have been extremely productive, and I hope that you had also been able to spend some time in enjoying in this beautiful city of Salamanca. It is a great privilege for me to be here and to be able to share with you some thoughts on my job as inclusion minister. Today, I want to talk about a subject that I have always had an interest in, and that it is migration. Having had personal experience on it in my own life, I lived in Frankfurt, in Switzerland, in Basel, but also in Mexico City, so I have been a migrant myself. I have long recognized that migration is the ultimate litmus test of the capacity of societies to adapt and prospect in the long run. Then in January 2020, as the Vice Dean just told us, I became Minister for Inclusion, Social Security and Migration, and I have since then devoted a considerable amount of time over the last 2 years to learning about it, thinking about it, and making decisions on it, on migration. Today, however, I would like us to step aside from our most present duties and take a broader perspective instead. I will structure my talk in two parts. First, I will run through a series of things we have learned in the past decades about migration, or rather things we should already have learned about both emigrants and immigrants, but that they are not sufficiently present in the current public debate. And second, I will try to draw some lessons about how we can use that knowledge to inform our future on migration issues, and most importantly, to design and implement our policies on it. Migration is one area in particular where I think it's important to get the facts right and to have a public conversation in which the myths and misconceptions are replaced by the evidence that academics and experts in disciplines such as economics, sociology, and demography have been working on. One of the most disconcerting facts these days is the widening gap between the debates that should inform policy making and the cynical view of politics that dominates public discussion. It is true that this problem of the disconnect between policy facts and findings, and the way in which these issues are portrayed in the public discourse is not exclusive to the field of migration. But in this area, it is a disconnect that it is particularly troubling in my view. Chiefly, this is because our political systems have witnessed the emergence of new actors who are intent on rallying support by playing on people's fears through disinformation and even hate. We cannot let these groups win the communication battle. We must confront our societies with facts and information, and we all have the responsibility here. Universities, the world that you represent here very well today, have an important role to play in improving the quality of our public debate too. The first stylized fact I would like to share with you is that migration is, above all, a powerful development tool. In fact, I would say that it is a development tool like no other. In terms of improving the well-being of those people who are forced to migrate, there are few policy interventions more effective than allowing these individuals to live wherever they want to live, wherever they are most needed. From a global perspective, we forgo huge gains by preventing people from migrating. We are preventing the use of these human capital resources not in the places where they can be more productive, thanks to the demand, surrounding infrastructure and the complementarities with other workers, instead of realizing these gains, we spend a lot of time and resources and times trying to recreate the conditions that would make these people productive in the places where they were born, with only moderate success. We have learned a lot about factors that are needed for growth, such as widespread provision of public goods, economic openness, a stable institutional environment, and others. But we don't yet have a clear set of policy receipts that guarantee long-term growth and well-being. The quest for growth, to use the words of a very well-known development economist, Bill Easterly, continues to be elusive. In contrast, letting people move around in the world so that they can live and work wherever they can make a better living is a seemingly easy intervention with huge gains for the individuals involved. Some of these gains surely come from the fact that migrants typically are not a representative example of the societies they come from, because migrants must overcome the cost that moving abroad entails. They tend to be less risk-averse, more entrepreneurial, more creative, and inventive than the ones that stay at home. This also explains why, in spite of the greater difficulty they have to surmount, they often participate more intensively in the labor market than nationals of the host country. Even more, US sociologists proposed long time ago already that immigrant optimism explains why some children of immigrants outperform academically their native peers with some socioeconomic better or even similar economic background. The fact that migration is costly also has an important implication that is often overlooked or blurred in our discussion. Within the countries of origin, the most deprived or underprivileged people in society often lack the resources, not just financial, but also cultural in terms of contacts, information, language, etc., that enable people to move. As a result, and even though there is quite a significant degree of heterogeneity across types of migration flows, it is often the better educated and the people with greater access to resources who are the ones more likely to migrate. A recent study that put together survey data from 99 low-income countries found that people actively preparing to emigrate have 30% higher incomes than the population on average, and 14% of these higher incomes is the result of more years of education. A direct implication of the notion that migration is costly is that, contrary to the common belief, the process of economic development is not necessarily a substitute for migration. More likely, the relationship between economic growth and emigration is not linear. In very poor societies, migration is prohibitively expensive for most people. As those societies grow and become more prosperous, larger segments of the population can finance probably with quotation marks, the cost of moving abroad. One estimate provided by Michael Clements, who in a recent paper finds that the poor countries' emigration rises as GDP per capita increases, this relation weakness significantly when the country reaches $5,000 per capita or reverses after roughly $10,000 of GDP per capita. So it is not necessarily true that economic development is a substitute for migration. More often than not, they act as complements to each other. This does not mean that we should stop supporting developing countries through development aid, but we should probably not do it as a way to stop migration flows. We should do it for the right reasons, namely that it is inherently a good thing to have more prosperous neighbors. It is good for them, and it is also good for us. There is empirical evidence that shows that the positive migration effects are not driven by the selection bias alone. Forced migration also provides a natural experiment environment that allows us to test the causal effects of migration irrespective of the selection effects. The evidence reviewed by Nobel Prize winners 2 years ago, Benardier and Duflo, shows that migrants need to adapt to new conditions and so develop a high adaptive capacity which fosters prosperity both for them and for the society that hosts them. One common theme in the most modern research on migration, and an aspect that we as policymakers must take more into account, is the centrality of what experts call circular migration. Thanks to lower transport costs and communication technologies, migrant communities do not remain as disconnected from the home communities as the Europeans arriving in the Ellis Island or in Buenos Aires back in the early years of last century. These days, many migrants work on seasonal basis, remain in touch with friends and families, travel back home often, and remain intensively committed to the development of their countries of origin. More importantly, they do this in a spontaneous manner, and this is beneficial for host and home countries alike. For instance, recent research carried out in the context of the EU Horizon 2020 project found that approximately 20% of the Senegalese immigrants in both France and Spain circulate between Europe and their country of origin. But our old-fashioned approach to migration often overlooked this phenomenon and does not create the right conditions for this type of migration to flourish. It is also important to recall what labor economists have found about the effects of migration on host labor markets. In most cases, migrants and natives are not substitutes, but rather complements, which explains why the wage and employment effects on migration tend to be null or even positive for native workers. On this issue, just the recently rewarded as Nobel Prize David Card produced very significant pieces that has been really provided a breakthrough in economic analysis exactly on these particular issues. As trade, migration might have distributive consequences that can give rise to legitimate concerns that we as policymakers should be ready to address. But just as with the trade openness, the system of legitimate grievances should not lead us to embrace protectionism or economic isolation. As in trade, it should lead us to accompany migration with policies that make migration beneficial, not just for some, but for all. In an aging economy, immigration plays two key roles. One, it helps to ensure the maintenance and reinforcement of the welfare state. It increases the ratio of dependents to the working population. And two, by expanding the workforce in a given country, immigration supports growth there. There is not a fixed stock of work that needs to be performed. In the long term, firms may change the technology to absorb the increased labor force and the increased demand. There may be differences between short and long-term impact of immigrants. Immigration can also absorb the jobs and skills mismatches in the labor market, resulting from the availability pool of skills of the native population. The education and training prevailing in a country may not necessarily be providing the right skills demanded in the labor market. Alternatively, it could be the case, and it is the case in quite a number of cases, the economy is not creating jobs that match the skills of individuals. A person can simultaneously be overqualified and underskilled. Migrant workers can help address this gap. Another economic benefit of immigration is it increases diversity and that is good for productivity as it fuels innovation. It is not casual that one-third of Nobel Prize winners working in the US and UK institutions were immigrants. Highly skilled immigrants can bring with them new technologies or new ideas that are then incorporated in the economy that have spillover effects for native workers. Immigration may help to address the short-term bottlenecks that may even have a geographical dimension in a particular country. The advantage of migrants over natives tend to be greater mobility with the result that such bottlenecks can be overcome with foreign workers. Finally, let me remind you of an interesting finding of many political science studies on the causes of political unease about migration in host societies. Xenophobic and anti-immigrant attitudes are more prevalent not among those people in closer and more intense contact with migrants, but in groups that perceive themselves as socially disadvantaged and in a process of long-term decline. In spatial terms, it is striking that in many countries, areas with more migrants tend to be more dynamic and cosmopolitan, are not the places where anti-immigration parties get their best results. The reason why this is so is still subject to debate. One possibility is that migration becomes more difficult to manage only when it is associated with segregation and social polarization, or that the evidence vindicates the contact hypothesis, the so-called contact hypothesis, which states that it is the lack of actual social interaction experiences with migrants that makes people hostile to foreigners. But one obvious interpretation is that the cultural diversity that migration brings about need not lead to political hostility towards migrants. It is not given that the experience of migration makes society more intolerant. According to Gallup, 25 years ago, 65% of Americans wanted to see a decrease in immigration, and only 7% an increase. Today, only 28% want immigration to decrease, and 34% want it to increase. Let me recap. We know that migration is a powerful life improver for migrants, that their effects on host countries' labor markets, welfare states, and the economy are overwhelmingly positive through various channels, and that diversity is not necessarily linked to anti-immigrant attitudes. How can all this evidence help us in the design of migration policies? It's a key question. First, we need to work more on creating the social and economic conditions to make migration work for all. We need to fight the biased narrative of economic competition between natives and migrants. But economic arguments might imply a level of migration that many people might find still too high. The native population might feel that some of the cultural traits are in jeopardy due to the lack of assimilation on the part of migrants or an unwillingness to accept domestic norms. But as the evidence shows, we should not be fatalist about the social problems that migration entails. What we have to do is understand better the reasons for skepticism towards migration, as well as address the legitimate concerns of affected groups. We should design migration and social policies in such a way that the benefits of migrations are more evenly distributed and visible for all. Creating and nurturing a positive atmosphere towards migration should be at the core of migration policies. I think this is very important. I firmly believe on this. Second, immigration policies need to be flexible, as they need to respond quickly to changing circumstances and to the new types of migration, such as circular migration I referred before. We often find that our norms are designed for types of migrants and migrant flows that no longer exist, while we don't have the tools to address the new challenges. Let me give you a small example of something that we are doing as we speak in our ministry. We are introducing new, simpler rules for hiring internationally in the audiovisual sector, which is strategic for us and requires a very specific type of seasonable international labor for which standard migration laws impose big obstacles. One important aspect of the adaptation of migration rules to the fight against irregular migration, which is often the result of criminal smuggling networks, that we should continue to combat with determination. Irregular migration is a serious problem. It leads to exploitation, greater inequalities, and social unease. But we should remember, too, that irregularity is frequently, I would say, also the side effect of an overly rigid system for regulated, predictable migration that does not work in the way it should. The more we can do to improve this regulation, the better able we'll be to design a predictable migration regime that meets our needs. We also need to be comprehensive in our approach. The effectiveness of immigration policies do not only depend on their design, but also on the instruments we use. Barriers to entry do not need to take the form of quotas or quantitative limits. As in traditional training we have learned, there can be implicit barriers too. A cumbersome application and admission system may deter workers from migrating. A slow process of cross-border recognition of academic or professional qualifications may be detrimental for the mobility of skilled workers. We need to look beyond border control, no doubt about it. And finally, And I am glad to be making this point at a truly European forum. We need to work and think as Europeans on these issues. The functioning of a truly European economic and monetary union demands a truly European labor market, in which factors of production can move around freely and respond to the changing conditions of the economy. As an optimum currency area theory shows us, migration is an asset, not a liability. It makes the economic union more resilient, the best of this important instrument. So the new directive creating the blue card at the EU level is a step in the right direction. We are already working in our minister in order to be able to transpond this directive in Spain in a way that can become a really very important instrument. So let's avoid the temptation to embrace narrow-minded migration policies to suit exclusively domestic demands. Any renationalization of migration policies would do great harm to the European project, and we do not only economically, but also politically. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, our dear minister, for this highly interesting and enriching conference. We decided to have it as a closing conference because of its importance. Such conferences belong also to the spirit of what we are working on in frame of the Alliance, European Campus of City University. So thank you very much, and hopefully we will have other chances to get such a rich conference in order to know better about this important topic. And now, as we are at the end of our 3 days, hard days, Congress or gathering, I have the honor to give the floor to our rector, who will be closing shortly this 3 days, intensive days, ECTU gathering. The rector, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Efrem, dear General Coordinator Ludovic, Vice-Rector. Thank you very much, dear Minister of Inclusion, Social Security and Migration. Thank you for sharing with us your vision, your experience, and especially because the university is a space for the difference, for diversity, and for inclusion. And this alliance of university should and will contribute to these objectives in Europe. And I mean that the university should be the place where different points of view and people from all over the world in this international mobility could share and improve their lives. That's our mission too. So thank you very much, because with this intervention of our minister, Mr. Escriba Belmonte, we have reached the best end of the third ECTU forum. And thank you very much for coming again to Salamanca. I hope that we meet us soon in the universities of the Alliance. These working sessions during these three not so hard intensive days, not so hard but very intensive days, have shown that our seven ECTU universities are advancing towards a truly European university macrocampus, and that we are fulfilling the goals proposed in the ECTU project. The various management bodies and working groups that make up the ECTU consortium have not only done an excellent job in the past days, they have also shown what our seven universities are capable of if they collaborate as they are doing. First, we are advancing at full speed, developing the type of research and innovation projects that the European Union is looking for in its higher education system. And second, the implementation of our joint multilateral master's programs will provide European students with a unique experience that will allow them to acquire knowledge from different points of view and study diverse research methodologies. Our joint masters will be a powerful tool in the hands of the present and the next European student generations. After all the work sessions and discussions that have taken place during this ACTU forum in the working groups and the virtual institutes, we can only congratulate everyone involved in the big ACTU family, particularly those of you responsible for the coordination. Thank you, Ludovic, again. The management and the correct development of the proposed activities. We are delighted to have been able to welcome, although Ephraim is so tired, to welcome you in Salamanca face to face. As you have surely noticed, the city and the University of Salamanca are very closely connected and cannot be considered separately from each other. We are thus ready for the creation of the ACTU ecosystem with the associated partners. The challenge is now to include society as a whole in our ECTU ecosystem, as we are convinced that the ECTU Alliance can only fulfill its mission and purpose, getting our cities and communities on board. I propose making true our own Alliance name, European Campus of City Universities, sign of identity. Salamanca, as well as the rest of the partner universities, fulfills its mission by involving local, regional, and national authorities in the project. Being inclusive is key because the ECTU project would like to make a real impact on society, and this can only be achieved if we collaborate very closely with local, regional, and national authorities. Thank you again, Minister, and entities. We, the universities, are committed to transfer our knowledge and experience to society. Although this has been the third forum of our ECTU Alliance due to the pandemic, it was the first one we have been able to hold face to face. Let's hope that the following ones can also be held in person, I'm sure. I'm completely sure. I wish you a safe journey home and a successful continuation of all the activities and projects underway. And thank you very much, everybody.
Well, after these words, encouraging words, after this excellent closing conference, dear colleagues, dear students, dear administrative staff, we have arrived to the end of our third forum. And I am highly happy having been able to celebrate it face to face because we needed it, because we were talking too much to each other through the screens, and now finally we were able to meet each other in person. We have been working hard, but at the same time we enjoyed it because this is a big family, it's not just an alliance. And this is what somehow Europe needs, creating this European spirit starting from the beneath, because it's the way of constructing the real Europe of tomorrow. So let's just close our forum. You are most welcome to a very nice place because we are not used only to use the Latin famous phrase orat et laborat, but we would say now laborat et manducat. So we are going to have a gala dinner in a very nice place, as we will have the honor and the pleasure to count with our minister. He will also be with us, and we can also share a while ideas while we are going to have something to eat together. And again, thank you for coming. Thank you for this excellent conference. And also, I'm thankful to the organizers, people who have been working without being here and in the photograph. This forum has been successful thanks to all of you, thanks to all the staff that has been really working hard in order to have everything in its place, being on time, and sometimes we don't remember that such issues are also important in order to have a successful gathering. If I'm not wrong, we have agreed next meeting will be in Pavia. Carissimi, ci vediamo a Pavia nel mese di aprile. So, thanks again, and let's go to the place where we are going to have the gala dinner, which is in Palacio de Figueroa, Zamora Street, number 15. For those who don't know, just you have to follow the rest of the members. Thank you again.
Hombre, es que hay que innovar porque es que si no...